Hi people, let's discuss what ICOs are, why are people doing it, and why are people putting the money behind ICOs, and what is the risk for anybody involved in this entire process. First things first, what is ICO? ICO is a method of raising funds, just the way you can raise funds from bank if you are going for higher education, or you can raise funds from venture capital for your business or from private equity, or you can raise funds from crowdsourcing for your business. Just in a similar way, ICO is just a method of raising funds. Now this funds, as opposed to all other funding we talked about, is raised in cryptocurrency, a cryptocurrency such as Ethereum or Bitcoin usually. So you have to pay in these currencies usually to get the coin of this new company that's doing the ICO. So that's ICO. It's crowdsourcing the funds for your company. How is it different from an IPO? One very important difference is that an ICO happens right at the start of the company, even before the product is out or there are any consumers or regulators, etc., looking at the product and the company, or any usual process of the company has not happened. Even before all of it, ICO happens, as opposed to an IPO, which is a very late stage event in a company's life. Usually a very good company would do it maybe in the first decade, but usually not even that. And it's after a level of revenue and net profit and presence and product and brand that companies go for an IPO and raise money from retail investors. ICOs go day one and raise money. Another difference is that in IPO, you would usually get traditional currency such as INR or USD. In ICO, you would usually get the company's token for Ethereum or Bitcoin or any of those cryptocurrencies. You will have to invest by giving cryptocurrencies, as opposed to in IPO, you'll have to invest by giving dollars or INR. Another method in which they are very different is regulation, and that is precisely the reason why people do it. Regulation on ICOs are in a very nascent stage and hence are not clear at all. So this gives the company way too much leeway to do things very quickly and not have to go into the paperwork, declaration, etc., which a typical IPO takes. So it's just so much faster and lighter to do an ICO as compared to IPO. So that was an ICO and how it is different from an IPO. What are the steps in an ICO? Pretty much everybody who has done an ICO has done this. They have crystallized on an idea. Most of these ideas, over 99%, are blockchain ideas. They have crystallized on an idea. They have decided this is what we want to do. Then they write a white paper on it. What is a white paper? It is just a product research paper, the way we used to do for project reports in our college. So they write a project report, if you may, or a business plan, if you may. That's called a white paper. They write in detail what their product is, why they think it will grow, what the team is, where do they think it will go, what is it in it for investors. So pretty much a business plan or a project report on their business plan, and that's their white paper. So crystallize an idea, write in a white paper, get a team that's credible in crypto world. There are not a lot of people who are credible in crypto world yet. It's a very, very small world, but get a couple of people. For example, if your product is microfinancing using Ethereum, then get somebody who has a lot of experience in microfinancing, the traditional microfinancing, and then it adds credibility. So make a credible team. A lot of investors will look for the team and will invest according to the team as opposed to just the idea. And when people have all this ready, they put together a website. It doesn't have to be a company's website. It just has to be this product's website. Put together a website and start marketing. Start marketing in places where you think people who are investors in crypto world are present, such as a lot of VCs, hedge funds, retail investors. You can find them off LinkedIn. You can do targeted marketing, etc. Find everybody you think will be a crypto investor and start marketing your white paper and your website or whatever else digital presence you create to these people. So they market it and then they open the ICO in couple of phases. First there's a pre-ICO, then there is an ICO, and then blah blah blah. So these are just different phases in which investors of different quantums are allowed. Like first most of the ICO companies will try to get large institutional investors on board to add credibility. Then they would open it to retail investors who would like buy some of the coin for one Bitcoin or two Bitcoin. Now one Bitcoin has become suddenly huge for a fraction of Bitcoin for a few bits. So they do it in phases. These phases vary for people, and then they will put different limits. The companies will put in different limits that in this phase, the amount of investment has to be minimum this, maximum this. In this phase, minimum maximum is this. And this phase will go from this date to this date, etc. So you basically, after you market it, you open it to your relevant target group to put the money in. How do they put the money in? There are websites that allow you to develop the ICO token sale on, and these people will go to that website, put in Ethereum or Bitcoin, whichever you allow on your ICO, and you will give them an equivalent amount of your coin. Say your coin is called your coin. No, that's confusing. Say your coin is called Canon Camera Coin. So you take Bitcoin or Ethereum from them and give them Canon Camera Coin. For example, when Ethereum is one of the biggest cryptocurrency now, it's the third biggest, it shuffles with Ripple. For example, when Ethereum ICO happened in 2013, I believe, for one BTC, they gave 2000 Ethereum. So they took one BTC. If I was an investor and you were doing the Ethereum ICO, you gave me 2000 Ethereum for every BTC I gave you. And now coming to why are people doing it? So today the value of those 2000 Ethereum is $2 million. So this is why people are doing it. So that was coverage on how are ICOs done. Write a paper, get a team together, market your idea, open it for raising funds. Whenever you opened it, collect all the funds and then close it properly. Make sure you are regulatorily aligned to whichever geography you are. That is a very important aspect of it to understand. Now, why are companies doing it? Why would you do it, or why is anybody doing it? Just for the reasons we mentioned in when we were comparing it against IPO. It's so much easier, it's so much less paper, it's not regulated industry yet in most countries, so you don't have to write all that declaration and file companies and full returns and blah 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 blah, and who are the people you can raise funds from. All those things go away, so it's so much easier way of raising fund. I want to give money, somebody else wants to take money. What are we doing dealing with regulation and paperwork? I raised money for another company once, not in crypto world. There's so much paperwork in raising money, and so much energy and money gets spent. It's very expensive to circumvent all of it. People are moving to this method of raising funds. It's so much easier, cheaper, faster. What is a catch then? What do you have to watch out against? What can go wrong? The entire ICO might be a scam. The pace at which the value of the coins issued in ICO rises or has risen in last 2-3 years, that has led to a lot of scamming and fraudsters coming in this world. And that's also the reason behind another risk that you face, that is regulatory risk. For example, if you bought coins in ICO and your government altogether goes out and says that you can't hold cryptocurrencies and ICOs are illegal, the way China banned all ICOs and even made some of the ICOs return all the coins to investors. So the pace at which the value is rising, that's gotten a lot of wrong people into it. And all these wrong people have gotten a lot of government and regulation into it. And regulations can be adverse. They might not always be favorable, both for you as an investor and for the company who's issuing the coin. So those are the risks, or those are the catch of an ICO. How can you protect yourself against that? If you're investing in an ICO, the most important thing is don't invest in ICOs where the background of the people is not very clear. Look for the LinkedIn, try and understand who are the people, are they really relevant, are they really doing it. The people really will determine if it's going to be a fraud or it's going to be the next Ethereum or next Bitcoin. So understanding the people will be very important. Understand the white paper, understand the concept very well. If all of it sounds genuine, scalable, credible, the people sound credible, then it's all good. Otherwise, you might be just putting yourself into one of these scam situations that do happen. Not all ICOs are scam, most of them are not, but you don't even want to be caught even one. And the other thing, of course, is regulation, both for investors and for companies, that can be very adverse. So watch out against those. for now. So that's that. That's on what is an ICO, how is it different from ICO, what are the steps to ICO, what are the regulations around ICO. Briefly we covered that, and what are the risks that anybody involved in this crypto and ICO world faces. If you have more questions, if you want me to cover any specific coin, any specific ICO, please write to me at hello@blockchainsemantics.com, and I'll be very happy to write back to you or cover the coin you want to. A lot of people reach out personally to me for opinions on specific coins. So if you have any, you can also reach out. Go ahead and do that. Till then, happy investing. Enjoy yourself in the crypto world. It's quite exciting. It's all new. A lot of excitement and things and drama happening here. So I'm all queued in. Hope you are also. Let's do the journey together. Let us know if we can help with anything. Till then, bye-bye.